First off, total transparency. Universal really rolled out the prehistoric carpet for this one. So here's what they did. They sent out a video invite with the T-Rex clomping across the screen, and they invited us to choose from three IMAX showings at a proper IMAX theater where they had booked out the theater all day long. You could go at 10 a.m., 2 p.m., or 7 p.m., right? I went smack in the middle of the day. I treated myself to a Jurassic World Fallen Kingdom matinee. And then they had these little guys at the entrance, adorable. They had their poses all worked out. And they even gave us a goodie bag, which I devoured during the screening like an Indoraptor. I was like, oh, I'll save these Doritos for maybe when I do the review. Gone. But, by the way, if you thought you liked raptors before this movie, oh, you are gonna like them even more. But I'm getting ahead of myself. The point that I wanna make right away, because I'm sure some of you are already typing it, is that, and I thought about this as I began to munch on my Jurassic World Doritos, I was like, you ain't buying my review, Universal, as much as I'm enjoying all this. And in fact, I turned to my friend, because they let us bring a guest too, and she was like, oh, are you gonna give this a bad review? Look at how nice they're being to us. And I was like, hey, look, I don't care how much Universal cozies up to me, I'd be shocked, if I gave this movie a good review, considering how all over the place the trailers have been. Well, I'm shocked, because here comes a glowing review. Seriously. And that's because the ad campaign for this movie really lets it down. It has all the Jurassic Park goodness that we know and love. I'm talking scientists, dino mercs. The beginning of this movie, it was like such an instant classic introduction. I loved it. And also the friend that I brought was like, I brought her as like my Jurassic franchise canary, because she loves the movie so much. And she actually, when I saw Jurassic World the second time with her, I enjoyed it more because she was just fanning out. And I was like, well, let's see if she likes this. And she was loving it. They have lots of cages, operating systems, everything. But for some reason, they didn't show any of this in the trailers. They even have bright lighting. I know, okay? Now, speaking of Jurassic Park goodness, B.D. Wong and Jeff Goldblum do cameo. B.D. Wong, of course, was in the last one as well. And their screen time is both so short. For instance, Goldblum, I do believe his scenes were filmed as an add-on, and you can tell. But they still both make quite the impression, especially Jeff Goldblum, who has one of the best lines that I've heard recently in a movie. I won't give it away, but it's about how change is like death. And I was like, ooh, that's a really sweet line. And I have to say that overall, Colin Trevorrow and his frequent writing partner, Derek Connolly, should be proud of this script. Not just for lines like that. At the end, you're gonna see I'm gonna talk about the best moment in the movie. But don't worry, this is a spoiler-free review. But anyway, they're able to split the movie down the middle in terms of locations, but still make it feel like a whole movie. And they're also able to move the story away from the theme park and the island in a way that I think this time will stick, because don't forget they did that with the second Jurassic Park. And it did not stick. There's also one twist in the movie that I saw coming, but it didn't make it any less clever. And I think a very unique way to continue, or one of the paths to continue the franchise on, that we had not anticipated. Well, I think a lot of you will figure it out while you're watching the movie, but still, it was a surprise. It wasn't something I expected going in, so I appreciated that. But there's one thing that's really new here, and that is that finally, it's 50-50 between the humans and the dinosaurs in terms of screen time. Like, if you like dinosaurs, I'm not even a big dinosaur fan, and I was like, wow, I'm getting like a front row seat with all these dinosaurs. I mean, I guess it's because this is the first time they've been able to do this in the franchise. And so I'm sure it's, you know, Bayona and Trevorrow should get credit for doing it. But still, I think that there's also something to be said for the advancements in digital and practical effects. Because here, you get all the dinosaur time you could dream of. And by what I mean by that is you really get to see a huge variety of dinosaurs. Like, really see them. You know, in the past, it's been like, was that a dinosaur sneaking by here? Although, JA Bayona has this thing where he has, like, from either it's like, there's some kind of light source that's blinking on and off, be it lightning or lava. And every time it flashes, the dinosaur is like closer, right? And he used it like at least twice. And both times it was still effective. I was like, damn, that's effective, J.A. Bayona. And this movie is just so scary. So scary! I wanted to say that later in my notes, but it's just really that scary. but in a fun Jurassic Park kind of way. But also, not only get to see the dinosaurs, you know, fully, but you really get to experience what it would be like to interact with them. Now, the real stars, of course, are Blue. You cannot get enough baby Blue. More flashback sequences in Jurassic World 3. But I also really liked the Indoraptor. The Indo, you know, the last dinosaur, I can never remember these stupid names they make up. It's the Indoraptor. Now, Indominus Rex... didn't like Indominus Rex. I mean, it was cool when he turned invisible. Oh, she, I'm sorry. But, you know, for the most part, meh. But Indoraptor, you know what I like so much about this dinosaur? That it was so intelligent and so evil that it should have had a mustache and a pinky ring. Like, seriously. I mean, I kid you not. I half expected this evil dinosaur to laugh. It was so deliciously wicked. Oh, yeah. And as for human villains, Toby Jones and Rafe Spall also were delightful. And while Blue is the dino hero of the movie, even she can't compete with Chris Pratt in this category as a hero, because particularly in this franchise, for some reason, they just really know how to use him. And he oozes hero like he's freaking Chuck Norris or something. Like, there's even some scenes where he's like diving underwater to save, you've seen it from the trailer, Bryce Dallas Howard and Justice Smith. And you just see him coming along and you're like, that guy's so cool. I honestly almost said out loud to Bryce Dallas Howard's character on screen, you should marry that guy. I mean, he was amazing. Now, Bryce Dallas Howard, speaking of her, she's a nice foil for his character, both as her own character and also as an actress. Bryce Dallas Howard and Chris Pratt are a nice match. And then the new additions, Daniela Pineda and Justice Smith, they are also a lot of fun. I really like them, particularly Smith, who's hyper, I'm freaking out here character, I could totally relate to. In fact, he was spraying mosquito spray on himself and they were about to go into the island. And my friend actually turned to me and was like, that's so you. And I was like, I know, that's totally me. And I was like, I was totally owning up to it. I was like, that would be me. So I loved it. And then Michael Giacchino, who does the score, you know, you should be familiar with his work by now, but he impresses once again. And he continues to be impressively unique, yet still authentic from film to film. I love his work. I mean, it's like other composers have a sameness to their scores, but his, you know, it's almost a detriment to him because it's hard to tell when he's the composer unless you're looking for the actual credit because he doesn't have a signature. His signature is just he's damn good, right? So he's great. That's why he's working so much these days. And then finally, JA Bayona. I owe you an apology, buddy, because I said he was the wrong choice for this franchise, trying to turn it into something else. But in fact, now that I've seen the movie, he and Trevorrow are successfully evolving, because they're not done yet. This is very much a transition film, but they're evolving Jurassic Park into Jurassic World. For the first time, when I saw the sequel, I understood, like, Fallen Kingdom still doesn't really make sense, unless they're referring to humanity. Maybe they are, but Jurassic World finally made sense to me, and it excited me, so that's great. They have created a film also, as I said, truly terrifying. As Bayona promised, he said he wanted to make a horror movie that was very scary like the first one, and he delivered. It was very, very scary. A lot of people got eaten. High body count. Just the way we like it. Okay. Now, so while Jurassic World, the first one, relied on nostalgia for the first Jurassic Park, it's this sequel that is actually a film as good as Spielberg's classic and a worthy successor. Okay, so now for what I feel is the defining moment in the movie. It caught me totally off guard. It comes out of nowhere, but it destroyed me. It was so sad and so powerful, and it happens like in the first third of the film. So you don't expect to be hit that hard emotionally at that point in a movie. But wow, it was so sad, again, so sad and so powerful, I actually burst into tears. It was that good. And for that moment alone, this movie is something that's truly special, and then everyone who worked on it, in front of and behind the camera, they should be proud of their work. You'll know it when you see it. I don't want to give it away! And don't you give it away either in the comments down below, because this movie's going to have a tough time because it's opening today overseas and doesn't hit the United States like for 3 weeks. It's crazy. I don't know why Universal would do that. They're putting audiences in a very difficult position. Now, speaking of going to see the movie, which I definitely suggest you do, I also suggest you see it as we were treated to in IMAX. I always say, whatever the studio, however the studio sets the press up for this for, to see the movie is how they feel the movie should be seen. And Universal obviously felt that IMAX was an important viewing experience. And I would agree, having gone through it. There's also a little stinger at the very end of the credits. My friend was like, they're not going to have anything. And I was like, I gotta see. And they did. They rewarded me. It was very small, very slight, but I appreciated it. And it kind of gave a little bit of a hint, maybe, perhaps, of where the third film might go. But it's very, very small, again. So that's my review. I look forward to hearing your thoughts down below. Again, please do not spoil the movie for anybody. It's a really good treat and give people a fighting chance. Save those spoiler comments for the spoiler review. And then, of course, as always, you can check out some more videos right now.